The Caribbean Center for Money and Finance must indeed be commended for inspiring this conversation here this morning. And in so doing, both the principal and the executive director of the center have already begun to shape what has to be a most intriguing day of policy-oriented discourse. I say so because when I look at the program, there is no doubt that it is relevant to our times and our challenges in Trinidad and Tobago, and indeed to the Caribbean. There is no doubt that the program has been organized with a certain logic in mind, and that logic is to enter into direct policy initiatives for the reform of this important industry in our country. And there is no doubt, when I look at the list of participants, that there is an impressive list of credentials that are going to be with us during the course of today and beyond. And for all these, I congratulate the University of the West Indies, its new leadership in intellectual discourse on policy matters, and for arranging this occasion here for all of us to benefit. Not too long ago, I was asked to contribute to a book that eventually was called No Island is an Island. What it attempted to do was to establish clearly the new interconnected world in which we live. There could have been no better evidence of the implications of that new integrated and interconnected world than in the financial sector in particular. We are all aware of different interpretations that have been placed on the events of the last few years, when the financial sector was indeed at the center of many summits and many decisions. The difficulties that these summits and decisions encountered is but a reflection of the need for us to understand really what was at stake in what erupted in the global financial sector. We know in Trinidad and Tobago, we had our own share of such eruptions. It was first thought that the world was facing what was traditionally called the phenomenon of a market failure, and large financial institutions in the pursuit of greed in a lax regulatory system had excesses in their behavior. A large part of the resources of the world, through the international institutions and elsewhere, were devoted to fixing what was conceived to be a market failure issue. But before we began to see the results of that set of initiatives, it became clear that the issue was much deeper than a market failure issue. You wonder how so many economists, so many policy practitioners had not made the link between market failure in the financial world to the issue of development. Because the sovereign debt crisis that emerged thereafter really was a continuation of a much deeper crisis. And we're all aware that even today, those matters engage the attention of the leaders in the world of finance, and more so today in the world of politics. Because what might appear at times to be a technical problem eventually spills over into the streets of politics. We have had many experiences of that over the many years. So what was the market failure issue was then seen as a sovereign debt issue, putting at risk the sovereignty of debt management. But even that became somewhat a partial analysis of what was taking place. Soon it became very clear that even the sovereign debt analysis problems were but a reflection of an economy-wide development issue. And so the original formulation of a solution with respect to Europe of a fiscal compact became inadequate to the task. And therefore the fiscal compact, which was used as a basis to introduce a new sense of discipline, became a limited approach. And now what is being discussed is a need for a growth compact. And that is why today the European Union is now going back to some of the very fundamentals of integration, recognizing that the structures of integration do not ensure that the processes of integration take place. And we have a current debate taking place in the political arena in France as they embark on the democratic exercise of going to the vote of a debate among the leading contenders between the need for a fiscal compact in Europe or a growth compact for Europe. It is in that context that I thought that we can look at the theme that no island is an island. For sooner or later, the spillover effects of these developments will affect us wherever we are, and already continues to affect us. And that is why today I want to place some remarks on the issues of reform of our institutions. But before I go into that, let me say in our own country, we have been well aware of the implications of these developments in the financial world, and we too had had our fair share of tremors. I say tremors, but in truth, it were much more than tremors. And we too have been able to overcome the hurdles of solving problems that was putting the economy and its financial system at risk. I must say that I believe that we have been able to successfully overcome those challenges and have contained the risk that were ahead of us and have averted the possibility of real danger in the financial world in Trinidad and Tobago. Having said that, and having done that, and having put the balance sheet of the nation in all its manifestation in some form of stability, we must now embark on the growth compact. But already we have begun to see the emergence of new risk. And today I just want to point out for this discussion the two emerging risks that we face in our own country if we are to sustain the advantage of policy measures over the last few years has to do in the absence of a workable social compact. Already, wage demands are going beyond our expectations or affordability, especially since they're dealing with wage demands of the years of 2008 to 2010. We are yet to confront the wage demands of today's and tomorrow's world. The absence of such a social compact is now one of the risks that we face as we manage the future of our economic direction. The other risk that I believe we face has to do with the investment gap. And the investment gap is a gap that emanates from both the public sector and from the private sector. And within the private sector includes our energy sector. The gap between delivery and policy is too wide. And I must say at this point that many of the expectations that were to be realized in the investment field, in the energy sector, in the private sector, and the government sector are yet to be realized. This poses a great execution and delivery gap. It is important for us in our policy embrace to begin to address those issues frontally. And if there's one thing as Minister of Finance I have never been afraid to do, regardless of the political cost of so doing, is to attack our economic problems frontally. And today, this seminar will give us an opportunity to deal with another aspect that is extremely important. Institutions do matter. And really, policy perspectives must have the right institutional framework. And it is in that context that the instruments, as well as the governance, as well as the effectiveness of our institutions in pension industry must now be addressed. I believe this is what you are about to do during the course of this month, or this conference. And in addressing the issues of institution, we must look with a clinical eye. We have had this morning a very good analytical framework expressed by the governor of the central bank, which provides some of the deep choices that are ahead of us. We must have a studied approach to making decisions on those choices that he has outlined so clearly in his remarks. The pension industry, globally, and indeed locally and regionally, have been faced with three major challenges in today's world. The first being what I refer to as the investment challenge, particularly with respect to lowering returns on investment and the funding of long-term benefits. And that must indeed be a matter of concern. For any final analysis, we have to look at the savings as a nation, as well as the savings in the pension industry, for that is the fuel that allows the industry to grow. And thirdly, the one that has been referred to here earlier is the whole challenge of demographic change. It was pointed out that in the United States, the percentage of population over 60 is going to move from 13% to near to 25% by 2015. And that trend is worldwide and affects us here too, in Trinidad and Tobago and the Caribbean. So the investment challenge, the savings challenge, and the demographic challenge are the broad issues facing us in the pension industry. It is against those challenges that we must indeed develop a reform agenda. A reform agenda that will in fact be able to confront these issues timely, urgently, and with resolve. One of the problems we have had in the Caribbean and in Trinidad and Tobago is continuous conversation on the same topics for every generation. Even pension reform. I am advised that the issue of pension reform was not addressed for 30 years. And although there were some attempts 10 years ago to start that dialogue, it soon faded into insignificance in terms of articulating a public policy response to it. We must shorten the period of conversation in order to have the urgency of political and policy action. I hope that the seminar will not be one of those continuous seminars over the 30 years to talk about reform, but to be able to come with the very practical, policy-oriented choices that must be made to make it happen. What are some of the gaps that have emerged over the last 10 years, and more specifically, over the last 3 years as we too grapple with our financial crisis? We already have heard of the pillars upon which our pension industry has been built. Senior citizens' pension, the national insurance system, the contributory private and public sector programs, and the individual retirement income. There is no doubt that we must deal with this problem. But how do we deal with it? They are complex issues. But the complexity of those issues must not deter us with a resolve to tackle them. When we look at the legislative framework that guides the pension industry, we see not only a long list of legislation. I am advised that there are over 10 pieces of legislation that governs this industry. And if you add many of the minor legislation, it is much more than that. We have dealt with pension in a piecemeal manner in the past. As the problems arose, we develop a response. And that is why today we have so many pieces of legislation dealing with pension. As Finance Minister, I am always confronted with the issue when I bring the Finance Act each year to Parliament, that I have to amend numerous pension-related acts to be able to make it consistent. Because of the system of legislative framework assist in that long delay. It means, therefore, that even policy measures will have major gaps for implementation. Apart from the legislative gap, there is the architecture for the pension industry. And I must say that the pension industry has performed well. And in spite of the fact that there are some financial challenges ahead of us, it is fair to say that the pension industry as an industry has been one of the major anchors for the sustainability of our financial system. And those who are involved in it should be complimented for moving forward and building upon that anchor. Trinidad and Tobago can boast today of having a solid pension industry. But that is not to deny that we must indeed move on with a reform agenda that will harmonize the pension program. And in so doing, we must look at the enforcement of new regulatory measures. And I believe the governor spoke to some extent on that matter. And as the institution responsible for managing the regulation of the sector, they have been involved in developing a new policy document to enhance the governance as well as the effectiveness of the regulatory system. There's urgent need for action. But while we are trying to build a new architecture, we must always be conscious that we have to deliver to the people. For a society will not always be patient on waiting for that day to come. So the challenge you face as a public policy person is to deliver on the run. And that also is what we've been trying to engage in. It is in that context that we began the reform with respect to the benefit structure of the pension system as we go on, increasing the senior citizens grant to a minimum level of $3,000, introducing some additions that will improve the effectiveness of the national insurance program and also increase the basic minimum insurance to $3,000. By that, we're trying to establish a minimum floor so that the people will begin to see the benefits as we conduct the institutional reform required. There is more that is in store. As we widen the net of beneficiaries in the National Insurance Program, we shall move to including the self-employed persons into the program, and the work to do that is ongoing. That involves an additional over 100,000 persons who will join that system in earnest. So on the run, we are widening the net who will benefit from the pension contributions, and we are also in the process trying to make and take such measures that will improve the efficiency of the management of these funds. All this has been done within the framework of a social policy. For in the final analysis, this is a matter of having an effective social policy. And I believe Professor Bourne in his introduction made direct reference to the social policy aspect of pension reform. We have been engaged in trying to find different ways that will complement each other, both from the point of view of social expenditure and from the point of view of pension reform, to improve the survivors' benefit of widows and orphans. To be able to introduce pensions for those who, in today's parlance, can be classified as belonging to post-retirement, because post-retirement itself is an employment in our country. And as I indicated earlier, the inclusion of the self-employed into the NIS program. And we are actively engaged in putting into place a pension program that will affect the daily paid workers in the public sector, who for too long have been without that coverage. All this that I have mentioned are measures, some of which have been put into place and others that are under serious consideration. But it's all done in the name of sustainability. Recently we had an interesting dialogue on what are the measures of sustainability in terms of macro management. And we have argued that sustainability is not a matter of arithmetical ratios, but is an ability of how can we adjust, how can we cope, and how can we build buffers. And in that sense, we have argued with the International Monetary Fund that their measures of sustainability are not appropriate to small economies in today's world, and that we must change the measurement of sustainability to the issues that I have raised. I must indicate to you that they have begun to listen. And they have agreed that there is need to reassess the measures of sustainability for small economies. From the arithmetical ratios of the past, what were sometimes called the fundamentals, to new measures that will measure your ability to adjust, your ability to cope, and your ability to sustain financial buffers. That interest that they have now expressed have been converted into a committee that has now been established into the National Monetary Fund of all executive directors who have small economies within their jurisdiction. An informal meeting have begun to take place and address this issue. These are issues that were raised by us in Trinidad and Tobago in our deliberations at those meetings, and we hope to see in the short term, even at that level, the articulation of the new requirements converted into policy measures at the global level. The question that I pose, therefore, is the measures of sustainability sustainable itself? This is an issue that I have no doubt that you may want to explore. And as it affects the pension industry, what are the measures of sustainability? And what really ought to be the measures of sustainability? We are well aware that in the final analysis we are providing a sense of support for the population, for the aging population. But we must not put at risk the sustainability of that public function. It is therefore in that context that I believe that this particular seminar is extremely important for us, from the point of view of the nation and from the point of view of public policy. It must fit into a larger problem of reform. Politics is not about winning immediate applause. Politics is about securing the respect of the people towards a program of reform. This is an opportunity for us to link the politics of our nation to the reform that is required in the future. But it will only come on the basis of hard technical and professional work. The clear identification of the policy choices facing us and the capacity to execute and implement whatever decisions are made. Those are all issues. There is a tendency in the Caribbean, Trinidad and Tobago, to say that the execution aspect will happen on its own. All that is required by policymakers from the university or elsewhere is to identify the policy choices. That is not correct. Policy choices is not complete unless it assesses the capacity of those choices to be implemented. And therefore, the work of the professionals must go beyond the mere identification of policy choices and must, in my view, address the issues of execution and implementation, whether it is through the legislative system, it is truly governance system, or whether it is true the institutions at the micro level. Many of you who are here are involved in, at the micro level in pension reform, and therefore the challenge is not only for the practitioners at the policy level, but it is also for those who are involved in the doing part of this exercise. It is in that context that I have no doubt that you will look at the standards that in fact influence the behavior of the industry, the accounting standards, the adherence to such standards, the compliance to the regulatory system, the transparency of that compliance, the service to the population in terms of the complaints that they have on the functions of the insurance industries. I think we can safely say that there are too many complaints. And although there is indeed a financial ombudsman in place, that remains a major problem for the population at large. We cannot therefore ignore in our reform agenda the need that in the final analysis we are about the service of the citizens of our country, our people, today, tomorrow. And in so doing, we must be able to articulate a road path. This, in my view, is an opportunity, timely opportunity, that we have as we have brought together all who have come here today to articulate with a clear purpose in mind how can we improve the insurance industry. How can we ensure that the gains of the past remained the anchors for building the future? And what steps we must take to so do? It is in that context that I look forward very much myself and my ministry officials who are supposed to be here, and I see many of the central bank officials here, will be more than delighted to continue this dialogue, Mr. Principal, with the Executive Director, so that your deliberations today can be converted into policy actions of tomorrow in the service of the people of Trinidad and Tobago. No island is an island, and in that sense, we must not at all ignore the international aspect of the policy changes that we're talking about today. But I leave that to all the practitioners as well as the presenters here today. I must say, when I received this invitation from the Center, Caribbean Center for Money and Finance, I was delighted. And that is why I thought, let me come and see if I can get some of my problems solved by your deliberations today. Thank you very much.